Hello, my name is Kyle Fenner, and I'm the Director of Community and Development Services for Elbert County. And this is going to be a very, very simple. Which one is forward? This is going to be a very simple to my right. Okay. Presentation. Basically, what I'm here to do is share an experience with you. I have no graphs. I have no charts. I have nothing, no fine print. I pretty much have pictures. And it's there for the backdrop just to create or, let's see, capture the moment. When I was hired at Elbert County, I've been there about 2 years, and I'm going to probably mention some people that are in the audience. I was hired, right after Memorial Day 2 years ago. My predecessor had been working on oil and gas regulations for between 2.5 and 3 years. It had been through the gamut. It had been through community input. It had been through everything. It was a 66-page document. It was probably in conflict with state regulation in a number of places. We had some feedback from the state's attorney general. Anyways, after I'd been there a week and a half, the BOCC, which is our Board of County Commissioners, was about to vote on it. The Planning Commission had approved it unanimously. And all of these people had volunteered. Everybody came out of the woodwork. We had committees writing it. We had, basically what it ended up was the activists wrote it because the activists were motivated. And the activists showed up at all the meetings. And the people who really didn't care about oil and gas were at home feeding their cows and just doing life. You know, they figured it'd come, it'd take care of itself. Our county is a little bit of a snapshot of the state of Colorado. We have high density in the northwest corner. They're all urbanites. They're all sort of bedroom community to Denver Metro. And then 2/3 of our county is big ranches, big spreads, 5, 6 generations people have been there. And they wanted oil and gas. But you know the activists show up. This was my inheritance. My office had reams and reams and reams of paper in it. And I had to figure out what was meaningful, what wasn't, what had been created by who. It was chaos. But I get to the BOCC meeting, again, on the job 10 days. The Board of County Commissioners threw it in the trash, looked at me, and said, go write some regulations. Now, the community was in absolute uproar because this was their document. At least the people that show up at the meetings felt like it was their document. They had approved it. They had had their blood, sweat, and tears in it. But again, it was a highly regulatory document. And basically, the message that it sent in general was, don't come here. We don't want you. And what also had happened was during the, this is what I say, anybody here a horse person? Okay. When a horse has really, really bad conformation, we say it was put together by a committee. This oil and gas regulation had been put together by a committee, and there were pods of people. There were the people that thought water was the hugely important element of it because we're dependent on groundwater, and we don't want them to use all our water. So there was the water portion, and then there was the setback portion, and our setback was, what, quarter of a mile, and then you had to notify everybody within a quarter of a mile of the perimeter of the parcel you were going to drill on. So if you were going to drill on a quarter section, it was just over the top. It was really, really over the top. But here I am, the newbie. I've got no friends. Nobody knows me at all. And I have to write the oil and gas regulations. And what had also happened in Elbert County was we had a de facto moratorium. And as you operate, as people who are in the business, certainty is pretty important. Knowing the future, pretty important. And all Elbert County was a political nightmare of uncertainty. Nobody knew what to expect. Nobody wanted to drill any wells in Elbert County. So during the whole boom, where everybody else was at least making some money, Elbert County was mired in its own muck. If you look at maps, we've got oil wells along our north boundary in Arapahoe County. We've got oils along our east boundary in Lincoln County, and we didn't have a single well drilled during the entire boom. And that was pretty devastating for the people who had leases. It was pretty devastating for the operators, probably, who engaged. So I start writing regulation. I am also, a little background on me, I'm not a land planner. I didn't come from the oil and gas industry. I didn't know what I was doing. And so what I had to do was learn. And based on what I could glean from the document, and I'm not going to stick on that too much, nobody had really talked to the industry. There might have been some outreach, and if I get nods from some of the people who were there, that's great. But there hadn't been a lot of input from the industry. It was really about us and what do we want our community to look like without any idea of what those regulations meant to an operator or how they were going to impact an operator. And I come from an economic development background, and so I understand what the gentleman from Anadarko just said. It's a business decision, and if it doesn't make any sense, we're not going to go there. And they didn't. And we are a massively struggling county, and we could use them. So everybody wanted to help Kyle write the new regulations. Everyone. We had big landowners out east who wanted to come help me. I had every fractivist, and that's literally the bumper sticker that they have on their cars. Everybody wanted to help because everybody thought they had the answer. I didn't have the background. What does she know? Why on earth should we trust her? They didn't know me. They had no reason to trust me. But what I did do is I engaged the industry. I had Nancy Prince on speed dial. I emailed Matt Lepore with pretty regular frequency. I emailed the state's Jake, if he's still here. I went on rig tours. I did ride-alongs with the inspector, with Mike Leonard. I did ride-alongs for the day as though I were inspecting wells, because when people came up to me and said, well, if you're going to require that, what does that mean? I wanted to answer it. I went on the air quality tours when those regulations came. I took ConocoPhillips' leadership program. I literally did everything that I could. I've been to this twice, and it was an immersion program for me. And I guess I'm not talking about what I'm trying to do here is say what you can do too. Most of you probably have oil and gas regulations. I don't know how good they are. I don't even know how to compare oil and gas regulations to one another. But I knew that we were a little bit unique because we had this very outspoken group of people. These are just my little fun things. But uncertainty does help no one. We had ranchers out there complaining, why aren't you drilling? We had the local fractivists saying, why are you even doing this? We don't want open pits. We don't want this. We don't want that. Without even being willing to listen to whether or not it was something local government could regulate anyway. The first document regulated all sorts of things that were going to land us in court with the state. I mean, we were going to end up being sued. And so what I had to try to do was find a way to make groups of people happy, or at least a little moderately happy, make it attractive enough for industry to come in. And what we did was invent some tools. Like I said, I went everywhere, and I asked a lot of questions. I got my own stickers on my helmets. I went through safety trainings for pipeline safety. I got all sorts of little certificates. And it's the other reason that I did that was that was not only my learning experience, but it was my outreach to the community that I thought had been overlooked in the beginning of the process. I just didn't think that we had real, I would say, honest discourse with the industry. When you have an industry representative come before you in a planning commission meeting and the audience is hostile, that's not a terribly fair environment to get input from him. And so I would show up on rig sites and get fair. I regularly have lunch probably every other month with a guy who is actually coming in with a well now next month. Nancy and I have, I don't know, we've missed our last one because of weather. I just stay in touch with people, and that's that networking thing. And again, I don't come from the industry, but now I could call Mike Leonard up and say, hey, Mike, I keep getting complaints on this well out in Elbert County, and Mike will call me back, and he's our regional inspector, and I don't know how many wells he's got. What are you laughing at? Oh, no. So here's, this is silly, but it's actually what I did. This fractivist group would show up in force. They brought people in from surrounding counties. They would populate every public meeting that I had. And all I was trying to do was figure out, what does the community think is important? You know, we figured out one way to regulate, or let's say make agreements, was to engage in an MOU with an operator. So we decided to go that way. We have two ways that you can apply. You can either go through a full-blown special use, which is about a six-month process. You got to go before two public hearing meetings. You've got to have a community meeting. It's quite arduous. But with that, your only requirement is to adhere to state regulation. There's nothing above and beyond state regulation. Have at it after you get your special use. The other way is what we call our administrative use, and it has three additional tools. One is an MOU. And let me tell you how I came up with the priorities of the MOU. I would be in meetings for 6 hours straight with people at the podium telling me what they hated, what they wanted, and it was just, it became so voluminous, how do you say that? Such a large volume of information that it wasn't meaningful at all. I couldn't even distill it. And so I finally got all these people together one night. We had a meeting, and I literally handed out Post-it notes. Everybody got three. And I said, I want everybody to put their top three priorities on the wall. And that wall is number one, that wall is number two, and that wall is number three. And, I mean, I collected hundreds of Post-it notes. But that was, I mean, I know this is simplistic, but that was the only way to distill what these people wanted. And it came down to about three things. But everybody that wanted to come to the podium would change it just a little. It really was about our groundwater. But this person says, well, it's about my groundwater this way. So that gave them the right to be at the podium because it was a new fear or it was a new complaint. So I got my Post-its together. I made a spreadsheet and I figured out we've got two issues really that almost everybody shares. Those were open pits of produced water, freaked people out, and produced water on the roads for dust mitigation, freaked people out. Kind of like the TSA. I don't think the TSA makes us any safer, but we tolerate it because it makes us a little bit more comfortable. So we wrote an MOU that says we'll put you through an administrative process. We'll get you through in about 45 days if you're willing to agree to not have open pits of produced water and to not use produced water on the roads. The other thing that we put in place, because we are a more than broke county, we are woefully broke. We've got 1,300 miles of roads and 1,200 of it's dirt, and trucks beat our roads up. So we have a road use agreement, and we have an operator bond for the roads. We do a pre-operation audit. We go out with them. Our engineer goes out with them. We say, this is the condition the roads are in now. You tell us what your haul route is. We'll go examine those roads. You do it with us. You operate after the fact. We want our roads returned to us in the condition that we found them before you started. So we actually don't, you know, that was another big complaint. The taxpayer didn't want to be on the hook for subsidizing oil and gas. And the third thing that we have is, being a large rural county, we have 9 fire districts in just our county. And some of them are volunteers, some of them are volunteer and part professional, and some of them are professional, and some of them have an answering machine and not even anybody at the station. So it was a challenge. Each of these fire districts was going to come in with their own little set of needs. One of the things of feedback that I got from the industry was, we want consistency. We want the message. Once you give us the message, don't change your story. We want to know. Everybody has said it all day. The industry is very willing, thank you, as long as they know what they're agreeing to. And so I got all of the fire chiefs in the county together to hammer out and agree to a simple 2-page fire safety and protection agreement. It's fixed. It doesn't change. It just says, you'll operate in this manner. And every operator that we've had come in, it says, oh, that's no problem. So we have 3 external tools. We've got an MOU that allows us to ask for 2 things that are slightly above state regulation. We have a master road use agreement that ensures that our roads get returned to us in the condition in which they were found. And then we have a fire protection and safety agreement that simply says you're not going to do dangerous things, and all of the fire districts don't even have to review the application. They said, oh, they've signed that document, we're good. And so it has simplified it for us and for operators. There's our fire districts, and it's about like that. So these are the tools that we built, and the largest priority really are those roads. I mean, our tax base is, we are reliant entirely on property tax. We have absolutely no retail sales. You know, we're right underneath Arapahoe that's got a mall, and we're right next to Douglas, and they got a big mall, and we're all the houses. And so these are the things that the people wanted. And really, in learning all of this, not knowing anything about it was probably the greatest asset that I had. I could be unconventional. There weren't any rules. I mean, I think I've been to your LGD training, what, 2 or 3 times at least. Immersion was huge. Reaching out to the industry, and not always in a business way. I mean, literally, I meet one oil and gas guy halfway in between us for Indian food, probably once a month. And we don't have the money for liaison. My entire department is 4 people. And that's all building, all code compliance, and all land zoning is 4 people for the entire county. So I had to build tools like this because we can't manage. We can't run around. With the MOU, though, the other thing that we can do is those elements can be added to their 2 and their, or actually their 2A, through a form. It's the sundry notice. And it, what? Form 4, thank you. So those can be actually added to the inspector's list of things to inspect when he goes out and looks at that well. So I don't even have to inspect those couple of things that he's agreed to. So I know that this is kind of a crapshoot conversation, but what I guess I'm getting at is simplicity is really, really good. That's where the Post-its came in. I was so busy holding these outreach meetings in communities and getting too much feedback, and part of that was the strategy. For activists, no, they can bury you in details and bury you in arguments. So simplify it. Find your own tool. Mine were Post-it notes. I know that sounds silly, but it worked. The other things are, you know, if you've got agreements, even say it's a school, sometimes these are little tools that really don't change the operator's experience at all, but it makes that entity feel better. The fire safety agreement is no higher than the state regs. Absolutely not higher at all. All it does is call the things out in the state regs that are important to the fire department, and it makes them feel good. So use tools, be unconventional, talk to industry a whole lot. You know, we had a de facto moratorium, unfortunately. We had so much controversy that the boom passed us by. I've got one more minute. And so we went into a lull. We're hoping we've got an operator coming in. He's just filed his 2 and his 2A and looking at 6 wells, which is huge for us. You know, right now we've got about 6 stripper wells, and that's it. So we hope that as it does come back over the next couple of years, that we won't get overlooked again. And we've got some pretty good tools in place, and I've met some amazing people in the process. And that's about it.
Thanks, Kyle. I hope you get some wells. Anybody interested out there? Do you have any questions for Kyle?